Hello students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Rajiv Jain from Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss about a module, Classification of Analytical Methods and Advantages of Instrumental Methods under paper Fundamentals of Analytical Chemistry. Here in this learning objectives, you will learn about classical methods of analysis, what were the classical methods of analysis, what were the limitations of classical methods of analysis, how qualitative and quantitative analysis can be done using classical methods of analysis, then different types of instrumental methods and advantages of various instrumental methods of analysis you will learn in this module. Analytical chemistry can be divided into qualitative and quantitative analysis. Qualitative analysis is the determination of quality of the substance, means different components present in a given matrices. And quantitative analysis is the determination of amount of each substance present therein. Quantitative analysis deals with the identification of substance, we can say. It is concerned with what elements or compounds are present in a sample. Quantitative analysis is concerned with the determination of how much of a particular substance is present in a sample. Another classification of quantitative analysis may be based upon the size of the sample available for analysis, depending upon the size of the samples. For example, when a sample weighing more than 0.1 gram is available, the analysis is spoken as macro. Semi-micro analysis are performed on samples of in between 10 to 100 milligram. Micro analysis deals with the samples weighing from 1 to 10 milligram, and ultra-micro analysis involves samples on the order of a microgram. So as I have discussed, classical analysis, which involve qualitative analysis, quantitative analysis. Quantitative analysis again divided into two classes, gravimetric analysis and volumetric analysis. So, but this analysis has some limitations. One of the great limitations is that their sensitivity is less. We cannot go beyond 0.1 gram or 0.01 gram of the substance. Less than that cannot be analyzed by this technique. At the most, we can analyze if we go in milligram, up to 0.1 milligram. So it is difficult to analyze even more dilute solutions by this technique. Another type of limitation is that when we do volumetric analysis, you have seen that we require certain indicators. Why indicators are required? Indicators are required to give end point, to give color at the end point. If suppose students solution to be titrated is colored, it is black colored, it is brown colored, then how we can notice change in color? That cannot be noticed. So to overcome these limitations, we scientists have developed different instruments which are based on certain physical properties, and that type of analysis are termed as instrumental methods of analysis. Quantitative chemical analysis started with the application of techniques of gravimetric procedures. In a gravimetric determination, a known volume of sample solution is treated with an axis of a suitable reagent, which quantitatively precipitates the desired constituent present in the sample solution. The precipitate, which is of known concentration, is filtered, washed, dried and weighed. Knowing the weight of the precipitate, the amount of the desired constituent in the test solution is calculated. For example, an axis of dilute sulfuric acid is added to a given solution containing barium ions. The precipitate of barium sulfate is filtered, washed, dried and weighed. From the weight of the barium sulfate, the quantity of barium in the given solution is calculated. Because such determinations are based on the measurement of weight, these are referred to as gravimetric determinations. Gravimetric determinations have
following advantages. These determinations are accurate and precise when using modern analytical balances. By these determinations, possible sources of error are readily checked, since filtrates can be tested for completeness of precipitation. Precipitates may be examined for presence of impurities. Further, it is an absolute method and it is inexpensive. Another group of techniques was soon developed in which quantitative analysis was achieved by measuring volume of solutions, hence it was called volumetric analysis. In this type of analysis, to the sample solution of unknown concentration, a reagent solution of known concentration is gradually added till the reaction between them is just complete, as shown by some indicator. The volume of the sample and reagent solutions, the concentrations of the reagent solution is also known, so the concentration of the given sample solution can be calculated. For example, a known volume of hydrochloric acid solution whose concentration is to be determined is taken in a conical flask and a few drops of phenolphthalein solution are added as indicator. A solution of sodium hydroxide of known concentration is gradually added through a burette until the solution in the flask becomes just pink. The volume of sodium hydroxide solution added is recorded, and from this the concentration of given hydrochloric acid is calculated. This process is called titration, and the determination is termed titrimetric determination. Titrimetric determinations has following advantages. It has advantages of robustness. Analysis can also be automated. High degree of precision can be achieved. Method is inexpensive, does not require sophisticated instrumentation. Over the last 50 years or so, there has been a growing tendency to make use of certain instruments to achieve quantitative analysis. For example, instrumental techniques such as potentiometric, conductometric, photometric, amperometric, etc. have been applied to locate the endpoint in a titration or to follow the course of a chemical reaction. It should be noted that in such cases, the titrimetric methods are not basically altered from their standard procedures. The instruments simply act as a substitute for an indicator. Recently, such methods, commonly known as instrumental methods of analysis, have been increasingly used, especially in the field of industrial and commercial quantitative analysis, due to their rapidity and sensitivity. Traditionally, instrumental analyses are divided into five categories, as shown in Figure 1. As mentioned in Figure 1, instrumental analyses are of four types, and one category is of separation method. Instrumental analyses are based upon the property of the assayed substance that is measured or used during the assay. The spectral methods use or measure some form of radiation during the assay. The electroanalytical methods apply an electrical signal to the sample and monitor an electrical property of the sample. The separative methods rely upon separation of the components of a sample prior to measuring a property of the component. The major separating methods are chromatography, extraction methods, ion exchange methods. These are the major separating methods. Most widely, instrumental methods of analysis include spectroanalytical methods of analysis. The spectral methods of analysis use an instrument to measure the amount of radiation that is absorbed, emitted, or scattered by the sample. If the amount of absorbed radiation is measured, the technique is absorptiometry or absorption spectrophotometry. Except for naturally occurring radioactive materials, radiation can be emitted from a sample only after the sample has absorbed energy from some outside source. If the absorbed energy is electromagnetic radiation in the X-ray, ultraviolet, or visible region of the spectrum, the subsequently emitted electromagnetic radiation is a form of luminescence termed either fluorescence or phosphorescence. depending upon the manner in which the de-excitation takes place. The major spectral methods of analysis are listed in Table 1, which include atomic absorption, atomic fluorescence, flame and atomic emission, ultraviolet, visible absorption by polyatomic species, chemiluminescence and electrochemiluminescence, fluorescence and phosphorescence, infrared absorption, photoacoustic spectrometry, scattering, refractometry, nuclear magnetic resonance, electronic spin resonance, X-ray method, electron spectroscopy, radiochemical spectroscopy, and electron spectroscopy. Some of the spectral methods which have been explained here briefly for introductory purposes are UV visible spectroscopy, IR spectroscopy, atomic absorption spectroscopy, flame emission spectroscopy, and atomic emission spectroscopy. UV visible spectroscopy refers to absorption in the ultraviolet visible region of electromagnetic radiation. The absorption in the visible region directly affects the perceived color of the chemical of the chemicals involved. Ultraviolet and visible radiation absorption promotes electronic transitions sigma to sigma star, non-bonding to sigma star, non-bonding to pi star, and pi to pi star. UV visible spectrum of a particular compound is recorded in conjunction with other spectral data such as infrared to deduce its molecular structure. Ultraviolet spectra, however, do not furnish prime information as such. It acts as complementary or even supplementary evidence to infrared. Another type of widely used spectroanalytical method is IR spectroscopy. In IR spectroscopy, it is the absorption of electromagnetic region in the infrared region, and it involves interaction with a molecule of electromagnetic radiation in the infrared region. In this spectroscopy, molecular vibrations occur by two different mechanisms. Quanta of infrared radiation can excite atoms to vibrate directly, and most organic molecules are fairly large and their resultant vibrational spectra are complex. Two spectral regions are clearly distinguished, region of group frequencies and fingerprint region. In group frequency region, principal absorption bands may be assigned to vibration units consisting of only two atoms. Frequency of their fundamental stretching mode is independent of influence of rest of the molecule. Such influences reveal themselves on careful study and offer valuable evidence as to the nature of neighboring atoms. Fingerprint region extends from 1400 to 400 centimeter inwards. Absorption bands found here are related to vibrations of molecules as a whole. Resulting bands are unique to a particular molecule. One exception to this rule is that a series of compounds such as long chain fatty acids can give almost identical spectra. If we see, the advantages of IR spectroscopy include that it is non-destructive, provides insights about functional groups present in compound, and it is cheap and very fast. Another type of spectroanalytical technique which is widely used is the atomic absorption spectroscopy, which was introduced in 1955 by Walsh and Alcamede. Using this method, a quantitative method can be developed by taking following factors into account. Because this is atomic absorption spectroscopy, in this first molecule is given certain amount of energy so that it comes into atomic state. So for that purpose, here a method is required for the atomization, selecting wavelength and slit width, preparing sample for analysis, minimizing spectral and chemical interferences, and selecting a method of standardization. This technique has the advantages of that it is easy to use, high precision, and it is also not a very expensive technique. Another technique based on emission is flame emission spectroscopy. Flame photometry or spectroscopy is based on the measurement of intensity of the light emitted when a metal is introduced into a flame. The wavelength of the color tells us what the element is, and the color's intensity tells us how much of the element is present. In early experiments, the visible color of the flame was used to confirm the presence of certain elements in the sample, particularly alkali metals and alkaline earth metals. Later, the whole ultraviolet and visible range was utilized using a spectrophotometer. This instrument permitted us to select the wavelength of the radiation and measure its intensity with considerable accuracy. Flame photometry is also named as flame emission spectroscopy because of the use of a flame to provide the energy of excitation to atoms introduced into the flame. Flame emission spectroscopy is highly sensitive and it is reliable for determination of elements in first two columns of periodic table. In addition to the determination of metals, it can be applied to non-metals analysis by utilizing the infrared region of the spectrum. Flame photometry is a simple, rapid method for the routine determination of elements that can be easily excited. Another type of spectroscopic technique is atomic emission spectroscopy. In emission spectroscopy, a sample is excited by absorbing thermal or electrical energy, and the radiation emitted by the excited sample is studied for both qualitative and quantitative analysis. Most of the spectroscopic techniques are related to molecules, but emission spectroscopy is related to atoms. Therefore, this technique is used as a method of elemental analysis. With it, all metallic elements can be identified and quantitatively determined in very low concentrations, as can be metalloids such as arsenic, silicon, and selenium. Either solids, liquids, or gases can be analyzed quite easily by this method. But most of the samples are solid or evaporated solids. Liquid solids are occasionally analyzed, whereas gaseous samples are rarely analyzed. Atomic emission spectroscopy is regarded as most reliable method for elemental quantitative analysis. The method can be used for quantitative analysis of about 70 metals at concentration level as low as 1 part per million. It is highly sensitive technique. Another group of techniques which comes under instrumental methods of analysis and very sensitive technique are electroanalytical methods. These instrumental methods of chemical analysis, in which either an electrical signal is applied to one of the electrodes dipping into the sample solution or an electrical property of the solution is measured, are electroanalytical methods. Most electroanalytical techniques apply an electrical signal while a different electrical parameter of the solution is measured. The electroanalytical methods are divided into category as shown in figure 2, and it is a group of over 16 different electroanalytical techniques. During analysis with most of the electroanalytical methods, electrical contact with the sample is completed by dipping at least 2 electrodes into the solution. Amperometry is the method in which potential between the 2 electrodes is controlled and the current is measured. When the current between the electrode is controlled and the potential is measured, the technique is called potentiometry.
Electroanalytical methods are based upon the movement of electrons. And in this technique, electroanalytical techniques, we apply energy in the form of potential and measure current. So there are 3 parameters which vary: potential, current, and coulombs. So on the basis of these parameters, these techniques have been divided into number of techniques, and today we have a group of over 60 analytical techniques. For example, if I take amperometry, as name indicates, that it is the measurement of ampere. We keep the potential constant and we measure the current. So this is amperometry. Another type of technique which comes here is electrogravimetry. You very well know electrogravimetry means taking the weight of the substance, and here substance is deposited by the application of potential on the surface and measurement is taken of that substance. Another type of technique here is potentiometry, means measurement of potential. Potential is measured. Another type of technique is voltammetry, means measurement of voltammetry. When we apply potential, current is measured. A sigmoid curve is obtained, and when we take here a dropping mercury electrode, electrode of mercury, then we call this technique as holographic technique. Another type of technique is coulometry. Metry again, measurement of coulombs. Either we may keep constant potential, then coulometry at constant potential. When we keep the current constant, coulometry at constant current. And when we do coulometric titrations at constant current, then they are coulometric titrations. So we can divide these techniques into a number of techniques. Another type of the conductometry, means measurement of conductance. Conductance, when we measure the conductance, this is another type of electroanalytical technique. So by manipulations or combinations of these three parameters, we may have number of techniques, and these are the simplest techniques. What are the advantages of these techniques? That not only qualitative and quantitative analysis, but we can use these techniques in the elucidation of reaction mechanism, in finding out the intermediate involved, trapping of intermediate, in finding out the end products involved, analysis of end product, elucidation of a structure of coordination compound, elucidation structure of organic compound, electro-organic synthesis, studying the kinetics of the system, thermodynamic parameters, all things, or its application, electroanalytical techniques, is there in each and every field of chemistry.
Another important method of analysis are radioanalytical methods. Radioanalytical chemistry focuses on the analysis of sample for their radionuclide content. Various methods are employed to purify and identify the radio element of interest through chemical methods and sample measurement techniques. The importance of radioanalytical chemistry spans many fields, including chemistry, physics, medicine, pharmacology, biology, archaeology, and engineering. Radioanalytical method has the advantage that it has very high accuracy, adaptable to wide variety of elements. They minimize or even eliminate the need for separations that are required in other analytical methods. Further, many analyses which cannot be done by other methods, they can be easily undertaken with the help of radioanalytical method. Another group of methods which are used for different types of analysis are thermoanalytical methods. Thermal analysis is a branch of material science where the properties of materials are studied as they change with temperature. Several methods that are commonly used include differential thermal analysis, differential scanning calorimetry, and thermogrammetric analysis. These methods have the advantages of high resolution, rapid response time, and easy measurement of samples of different configurations. Another method, which are methods commonly used in chemistry or which are required, are the separative methods. The separative methods take advantage of physical or chemical properties of the components of a mixture to separate the components. After the separation, the components can be individually assayed either qualitatively or quantitatively. Sometimes the separating instrument simultaneously performs the separation and the assay. In other cases, the separation is done prior to an assay by another method. Among the non-instrumental separative methods are distillation, extraction, precipitation, filtration, osmosis, and reverse osmosis. Another type of methods which are based upon extraction are chromatographic methods. Chromatography is the method by which a mixture is separated into its components as a result of the relative ability of each component to be flushed along or through a stationary phase by a mobile phase. So this chromatography has been developed, and nowadays number of chromatographic techniques are available, which include paper chromatography, thin layer chromatography, gas chromatography, high performance liquid chromatography, based upon the principle that one of the phases is stationary phase and another is mobile phase, and separation takes place on the basis of theoretical plates. If partition is involved, if adsorption is involved, then it is based upon the adsorption affinity of different substances.
So you have seen different types of instrumental analysis, and these are based on certain physical property of the substance. You have seen above that there are spectroanalytical, electroanalytical, thermoanalytical, radioanalytical, and then there are various separation methods. What are the advantages of instrumental methods of analysis? The principal advantage is that they are very sensitive. Sensitivity, and they are very selective. We can go up to 10 raised to power minus 12 or minus 30 molar solutions, which is not possible by any classical method. Another major advantage that we can do both qualitative as well as quantitative analysis simultaneously. In classical methods, first you have to do quantitative analysis, you have to remove various types of interferences, then you, after finding out the substance, you have to do quantitative analysis, that too, that limitation, with the limitation that the sensitivity of the method was not much. But here, the methods are very sensitive and selective. Another advantage is that in case of volumetric analysis, you have seen that indicators required for measuring the color change. Here, no indicator is required. Automatically, instrument can find out the end point. So these methods are very selective, sensitive, interferences are less, and further, the perception of one person to another, that error is eliminated. As you have seen in colorimetric, the measurement, if we see colorimetry, color is measured with the help of instrument. So its perception of eye does not vary. But in case when we notice the color change with the help of indicator, then it may vary from person to person. So here, various errors which were there in classical methods of analysis, these errors are avoided in instrumental methods of analysis. That is why instrumental methods are nowadays much more in use. But we cannot say that classical methods, that is qualitative and quantitative analysis based on gravimetric and volumetric mixture analysis, can be done away with. But these methods have their own importance. So students, today you have studied a very interesting study. What are the limitations of classical methods of analysis? What are the advantages of instrumental methods of analysis? In classical method means the methods which started from very early days, from the days of alchemists. In early days, people used to take out alcohol from plants by very crude methods. Now these methods have been refined later on. Later on came our distillation, fractional distillation. Then the principle of fractional distillation was used in chromatography. So from classical methods of analysis, we proceed to modern instrumental methods of analysis. But the basic principle remains the same, means qualitative analysis and quantitative analysis. Instrumental methods analysis have been increasingly used, especially in the field of industrial and commercial fields, due to their rapidity and sensitivity. with the advent of instrument, now instruments are being added at every stage of the development of a product, at every stage of synthesis of a product, and at every stage we check the purity of the product so that next batch does not go waste. At each stage of synthesis, we analyze the product, we check the purity of the substance, then we proceed further. So these are the, we call them as process instruments. Combination hyphenated techniques then developed. Hyphenated techniques, we combine two techniques to work. Most common example of that, combination of GC mass, LC mass, that we are getting a product coming out from gas chromatograph, and then immediately we are sending it to the mass spectrometer where it is being identified, detected. So with the advent of modern instrument, our analysis is becoming more sensitive and select. Thank you.